Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core exam. In this lab, we will review some of the ARP concepts we covered in the previous video. In this network, we have four routers, and as it says in the lab notes, the subnets are 192.168.xx.0/24, where XX is the router number of each router connected to the segment. For example, 192.168.12.0/24 for the connection between R1 and R2. Also, the IP addresses are .x, where x is the router number. For example, all of R2's IP addresses end in .2. R3's IP addresses end in .3, etc. I'll try to use addressing schemes like this when possible to make the labs easier to follow. Now let's get right into it. Step 1 says to debug ARP messages on R1 and R2. And there's a note saying that additional configurations are needed to display debug messages via the console connection. I'll open the CLI of R1 first. Enable. So first I'll enable ARP debugging. The command is simply debug ARP. This means log messages will be generated for various ARP-related events, such as sending and receiving ARP messages. Now, we have to ensure that these log messages will be displayed via console connections. As you probably guessed by the name of the console tab here in CML, this CLI is like connecting to the console port of a physical device, not a remote connection like SSH or Telnet. So I'll use show logging. And here at the top, you can see the status of logging to the console, disabled. Note that this actually isn't default. I disabled console logging just to make the point that you will need this enabled to see debug messages via a console connection. So let's enable it. Conft. The command is logging console. That's it. We need logging enabled at debugging level, which is syslog severity level 7, to see debug messages. But that's the default, as indicated by this log message here, level debugging. So there's actually no need to specify debugging in the logging console command. Okay, now I'll head over to R2 to do the same. Enable debug ARP conft logging console. Okay, that's all on R2 for now. Let's take a look at the lab instructions again. Step 2 says to initiate a packet capture on the link between R1 and R2. So I'll click on that link in the topology and go to the Packet Capture tab. Now I'm going to go to Settings and increase the max packets to something like 500. I'll manually stop the packet capture. No need to stop it automatically after just 50 packets. So now we're ready to start the packet capture, and we'll analyze it after the other lab tasks. Let's go back to the lab notes for step 3. It says to configure two static routes on R1, a recursive route to 192.168.23.0/24, and a directly connected route to 34.0/24. If you'll remember from the CCNA course, a recursive static route is when you specify only the next hop IP address in the route, and a directly connected static route is when you specify only the exit interface. So let's return to R1 and configure those routes. First, the one to the R2-R3 segment. IP route 192.168.23.0, 255.255.255.0, and this should be a recursive route, so let's specify R2's IP, 192.168.12.2. Okay, now we have some interesting output here. After configuring the static route, we get some ARP debug messages. As it says in the first message, R1 created an entry for IP address 192.168.12.2. Why is that? Actually, when you configure a static route and specify the next hop, the router will automatically send an ARP request for that next hop IP address, so it has an entry in the ARP table. Let's check the ARP table. Do show ARP. There it is, 192.168.12.2. It has already learned R2's MAC address. By the way, I've already configured static routes on the other routers, so let's check another one, for example R3, to see if it has done the same thing. Enable Show ARP. As you can see, it already has ARP entries for 192.168.23.2, which is R2, and 34.4, which is R4. Let's check the routing table. Show IP route. At the top, there is a route to 12.0/24, and as you can see, the next hop is 23.2, R2. However, it has no routes with R4 as the next hop, so why does it have an ARP entry for R4? It's because R4 is using R3 as the next hop for its routes. So R4 sent an ARP request to R3, and R3 used that to make an ARP entry for R4. Okay, so that's just an aside and something I didn't mention in the previous video. Let's get back to R1 and configure that other static route. This time a directly connected static route. IP route 192.168.34.0/24 G00. Note that this time, there are no debug messages. That's because we didn't specify a next hop IP address. For directly connected static routes, the router won't automatically send an ARP request until it actually tries to use that route to send a packet. Okay, now I'll use end to return to privileged exec mode, and let's go back to the lab notes. Step 4 says to ping R2's G00 interface from R1, and also asks if there is any new debug output. What do you think? Will there be any new ARP messages? Let's try that ping. Ping 192.168.12.2. Okay, we immediately get responses, and there is no new debug output. That's because, after specifying R2 as the next hop for that static route we configured, R1 already used ARP to learn R2's MAC. No need to do it again. Okay, back to the lab notes again. Next, in step 5, we are told to ping R3's G00 interface. That would be IP address 192.168.23.3. It also asks if R1 sends an ARP request. Why or why not? What do you think this time? Will R1 send a new ARP request? Let's try that ping and find out. Ping 192.168.23.3. The ping works, and again, there are no new ARP messages. Why is that? It's because R1 already used ARP to learn the MAC address of the next hop, 192.168.12.2. We specified it in the static route to the 23.0/24 network. So let's go back to the lab notes. And step 6 says to ping R4's G00 interface. That is IP 192.168.34.4. It also seems the ping will fail, and we must find out why. Also, do you think R1 will send a new ARP request? It already knows R2's MAC address, so what do you think? Let's try that ping. Ping 192.168.34.4. Okay, I don't see any ping replies. However, as you can see, R1 is trying to send ARP requests, but we don't see any responses. Why does R1 need to use ARP, even though it already knows the MAC of the next hop, R2? Well, the current entry for R2 in the ARP table is mapping IP 192.168.12.2 to R2's MAC address. However, we configured the route to 192.168.34.0/24 as a directly connected route. R1 thinks the network is directly connected to the G00 interface. So instead of sending the packet to next hop 192.168.12.2, it tries to send it directly to the destination 34.4. So that means it must use ARP to learn the MAC address of 34.4. As you can see in these debug messages, it's sending ARP messages to 192.168.34.4. Of course, R4 never hears these broadcast messages. However, using proxy ARP, it is possible for R2 to reply on behalf of R4, and tell R1 to use R2's own MAC address as the layer 2 destination for those packets. R1 will think it is sending packets directly to R4, but really, R2 will receive them instead, and then forward them on to R3, and then R4. Let's go back on R2. As these debug messages show, R2 received the ARP requests from R1. Let's check R2's routing table. Do show IP route. At the bottom, it does have a route to 192.168.34.0/24. Because it has a route to the destination, it is able to use proxy ARP to reply on behalf of that destination. But why doesn't it? Let's check. Do show IP interface G00. Here is the problem. Proxy ARP is disabled. That's why R2 won't respond to R1's ARP requests for 192.168.34.4. Now, proxy ARP is enabled on router interfaces by default, but let's check the config of R2 G00. Do show running config, interface G00. As you can see, I disabled it with no IP proxy ARP. So let's enable it to allow R1 to ping R4. Interface G00, IP proxy ARP. Now let's try that ping again on R1. Ping 192.168.34.4. Once again, R1 tries to ARP directly for 192.168.34.4, and this time it actually gets a reply. And after it learns the MAC address, the ping works. Let's check the ARP table. Show ARP. There's the new entry, and notice that the MAC address is the same as the entry for 192.168.12.2. That's because R2 used proxy ARP to respond on behalf of 34.4. Even though it isn't R2's own IP address, because it has a route to the destination, it decided to reply to R1's ARP request. Now let's go back to the lab notes. We actually just did both step 6 and 7, and noticed in R1's ARP table that R2's MAC was used for both the 192.168.12.2 and 34.4 entries. In step 8, it says to change the ARP timeout of R1's G00 interface to 3 minutes, and then it asks after how much time R1 will attempt to refresh R2's ARP entry. So let's return to R1 once more. Let's check with the current timer when R1 will attempt to refresh R2's ARP entry. The command is show ARP 192.168.12.2 detail. The exact time that displays for you will be different than for me, but just take note of it. Now let's change the timeout to 3 minutes. Conf T, interface G00. The command is ARP timeout, and I'll check the options here. As it says, this command is configured in seconds. So if you enter 3 here, R1 will basically be endlessly refreshing its ARP entries, because the timer is set to 3 seconds. For 3 minutes, let's configure 180. Now notice after configuring that, R1 sends out new ARP requests for 192.168.12.2 and 34.4. That's because after changing the timeout, it immediately tries to refresh the ARP entries and use the new timer. Let's check when R1 will try to refresh R2's entry. Do show ARP 192.168.12.2 detail. So here is the timer for me. The number will of course be different for you. Although we configured the timeout of 3 minutes, the number here is quite a bit different for a few reasons. First, R1 will add a random jitter value to the timeout, so each ARP entry has a different timer, and they don't all refresh at the exact same time and flood a bunch of ARP traffic. Second, the timer displayed in this command isn't the actual time until the entry times out and is removed from the table. It's just the timeout until R1 attempts to refresh the entry. Remember, R1 will attempt to refresh an ARP entry a few times before actually removing it from the ARP table. Okay, now let's go back to the lab notes. Step 9 says to use Wireshark to examine each ARP exchange in the packet capture. So I'll go back to the link between R1 and R2 and stop that packet capture. You can then download it and view it in Wireshark. Actually, I have a packet capture that I already prepared. Let's use that. I will include this packet capture with the downloads for this lab, by the way, in case you are unable to do the lab yourself. We don't have to spend so much time on it now, but let's go through what we did in this lab. Up top, messages 3 and 4 in my capture, we have the ARP exchange after I configure the recursive static route on R1. R1 ARP'd for the next hop address, 192.168.12.2, and got a response from R2. Then we pinged a couple times, to R2 and then to R3, at 192.168.23.3. In messages 29 to 35 in my capture, we have 5 ARP requests from R1, with no response. This is when I first tried to ping R4 from R1, but proxy ARP was disabled on R2's interface, so it didn't respond to R1's ARP requests. Then, after enabling proxy ARP, I tried the ping again, and R1's ARP request was finally answered by R2, and the ping worked. Then there are 2 more ARP exchanges under here, messages 50 to 53. This is when I changed the ARP timeout of R1's G00 interface, and it refreshed the entries it learned on that interface. Then finally, at the bottom, there are 2 more exchanges. These are after the refresh timers counted down to 0, and R1 once again refreshed the entries. Notice that there was a bit of a time difference between refreshing the 192.168.34.4 ARP entry, this 20 here means 20 seconds, and refreshing the 12.2 entry, this 25 means 25 seconds. Because of the random jitter value added to the ARP timeout, these 2 ARP entries were refreshed about 5 seconds apart from each other, rather than refreshing at the same time. Okay, that's all for this lab. Even if you completed this lab successfully, I recommend spending some time experimenting with ARP yourself. If you have any questions like, what if I did this, or what if I did that, try it out and find the answer. That is one of the best ways to learn. Okay, thanks for watching. I hope you learned something new. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Boson Software, Velva Jacob, George Streeter, Funny Dart, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo Biar, Gerard Baker, Marcel Lord, Pavel M., Mr. Erlison, Dragos Hirnea, Zakib Shah, Mir Salman, Mason Anderson, Vitaus 194, Gina Lindley, Nahemia, Justin Watke, Bold 1C1U, Mark Jackson, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaume, Gabriel Braga, Renan Marias, Hector Hernandez, Ali Polat, Mara Tuba, R. Nelson, Roji Kuriakos, Rasko Roy Gamer YT, Owad, Arpad Conives, 5 Feet, Daniel Brown, Emiliano Correa, Tricky Mickey 123456, Scott Thompson, Jose Alvarez, Kevin Hayes, ES, William Rosario, Hussein Yavus, Samuel Tavares, Mustafa Ursoy, Dear Diso, Nasser Zahar, Alexandru Badic, and Brian Grant. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So, if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching. Thank you.